This is NDTV. And you're watching NDTV 24/7.
Welcome to our special show on coronavirus. All the questions that you have regarding this deadly disease, its spread, its testing and its treatment, those questions will be answered right here. Joining us today, we have Dr. Rakesh Sahay, Professor and Head Department of Endocrinology at the Usmania Medical College and Hospital, Hyderabad, and Dr. Praveen Shankar, a Senior Consultant, Endocrinologist and Diabetologist from Ranchi. Thank you so much, doctors, for joining us this morning and sparing your time to answer all the questions people have, especially now we're in the 21st day of the lockdown and we're waiting to and every day we're seeing the numbers go up. There are over 9,000 cases of coronavirus currently in India. We have a caller from Kolkata already, Anjan, calling in. Go ahead with your question, Anjan.
Morning, ma'am. Morning, doctors. I hope you guys are doing well. My name is Anjan. I have a history of tuberculosis, which I got in 2014 and got completely cured. I also have a history of two pituitary gland tumor operations, one in 2011 and one last year, August. I don't have diabetes. I don't have hypertension. I have no symptoms now. I'm doing fine. I take steroids. Am I more susceptible to this COVID-19? Do I have to take? Or patients like me, do they have to take extra precaution? I'll be grateful to get your advice.
All right, Dr. Sahay.
Yeah. So as we see, Ms. Anjan, you have had a previous history of tuberculosis, which was treated well. So that probably doesn't pose any additional risk. But the point that you had two pituitary surgeries and you're on steroid replacement, you have to be very careful that you continue with your steroid replacement. Don't stop that. And in case you develop fever, you should increase the dose, because you need a higher dose during any illness, and you should continue with your oral medication, increasing the dose. And in case your fever becomes higher, then you need to have consult a doctor, and then accordingly they may look at giving you intravenous steroid.
All right, and Dr. Shankar, anything you'd like to add to that?
I think Dr. Sahay has already covered everything, so I don't have anything more to add to it. Thank you.
All right. We have Chandan calling from Buxar. Go ahead with your question.
Yeah, ma'am. Good morning to all.
Morning.
Yeah, it is not my question. It is not only my question. One of my friend Manipur, it is also answered this question. My question is this. Which part of body affected most by the coronavirus?
All right. Dr. Shankar, he wants to know which part of the body is most affected due to the coronavirus.
This virus enters your body through the respiratory tract, and after entering the respiratory tract, it resides in your upper respiratory tract. In common words, we can say that it resides in your throat, multiplies, and then attacks your lungs. So lungs are the primary target organ for this virus. So once the lungs are affected, some patients develop severe pneumonia, which is also known as ARDS in medical terms. And they go on developing septic shock as well, and then they go into multi-organ failure.
All right. We have a caller from Hyderabad, Jogeshwar Rao. Go ahead with your question.
Good morning, doctors, and good morning, Dr. Gorgi again. Actually, it is case with mostly related to senior citizens of my kind. I'll go through my status to the question. Actually, I'm having several morbidities, like I underwent PTCA three times, having three stents. I'm taking insulin for diabetes and detected for fatty liver and enlarged prostate, so many things. But I'm more healthy than the ordinary person, healthy person, so due to morning walks, evening walks. So my question now, I'm arriving at my question, whether the life is going to be COVID, life with COVID or life post-COVID. In either case, the senior citizens like me will be able to lead a normal life as before.
All right, Dr. Sai, first to you, and this I suppose is something many are wondering, because even if the lockdown were, you know, is extended, however long it does take, this is something that's going to be with us for many months to come, and we're awaiting a vaccine. But yes, you know, a lot of senior citizens wondering how life will continue for them, and then what all changes that they'll have to incorporate.
Yeah, Mr. Jogeshwar Rao, what we need to realize is that this infection is causing little more serious manifestations in older individuals. So that's why we want to protect you from developing infection. And as long as you don't develop infection, life is going to be the same. And the major issue is that you need to prevent infections. And by taking all the precautions that have been mentioned time and again, everywhere in the media, you're seeing this, that is washing hands, keeping a safe distance from other people who may be having infection, and also avoiding contact with various surfaces, and avoiding touching your face. So if you're able to do this, you'll be able to prevent infection and can lead a normal life.
All right. And Dr. Shankar, another question that we often get is, a lot of people with diabetes these days, if for them to control diabetes, they do require a lot of walking. People walk 5 to 6 kilometers. And because of the lockdown, a lot of them are especially worried about that. What would your advice be to them?
They have to continue with their exercise, and say they can do inside their house. Like they can, if they have got a treadmill or a cycle, they can do cycling or treadmill. If they don't have anything, they can just walk inside their house and measure the distance and cover about 2, 3, 4 kilometers, whatever they have been doing so far. So the thing is that they can't go outdoors right now because of the lockdown. So they can do all these exercises at home.
Even yoga is a good form of exercise.
All right, and there are many videos and apps these days that can, you know, help you exercise in your homes as well. We have a caller from Srinagar, Muhammad Muzaffar. Go ahead with your question.
Hello, good morning.
Good morning.
If a pregnant mother catches a COVID-19 infection, will it get transmitted to her child which is in her womb? Or is it mandatory to go for the testing of the child once it is born?
All right, yes, there's been a lot of talk about this, passing on the coronavirus from mother to child. Dr. Sahe?
Yeah, so actually, if you look at it, we have had a few cases developing in pregnant women who have become infected. And in all these instances, we have seen that the children who were born were not infected. So there is no transmission from the fetal-maternal route. But we need to be careful. We need to check the child and then take appropriate precautions to prevent infection of the child once a child.
And some concerns regarding also post the delivery, breastfeeding the child. Any concerns about that? Anything you can tell us? Because there's, you know, a lot of doubts regarding that.
Yeah, the breast milk is not going to transmit the infection. But it is with the, again, with the aerosol generated by the mother that could be infective. And therefore, the mother has to take the precautions to prevent infection to the child.
All right. We have a caller from Bengaluru. Murli, go ahead with your question.
Thank you. Thank you for having me on the show. Good morning, doctors. My question is, what are the effects once cured? What are the, any chance of getting relapsed? Okay, and I see some news over it, getting relapsed and getting COVID-19 again. And what are the measures after the lockdown has been removed? What are the measures that needs to be taken?
All right, Dr. Shankar, first, you have a very important question regarding this relapse that we're hearing about. A lot of confusion, a lot of talk of, false negatives. And so this is creating a lot of anxiety regarding coronavirus and people getting it again.
Yeah, actually, we first have to know the limitation of the test that we are doing. RT-PCR is able to pick up 70% to 80% of cases at any given time. And the pickup depends on the viral load on the person on which the test is being performed. So many a times the test may come negative because the virus load is low on the patient. And later on, when the test is repeated because the virus load is high, the test comes back as positive. So what the scientists are thinking right now is that it's not a reinfection, it's a reactivation of the virus. That is what is happening.
It actually never left the body.
But Yeah, but the knowledge on this subject is still evolving, so we don't have any definite answers on that.
All right, and Dr. Sahe, also a lot, the people who take the test have to be very well trained because, you know, the swabs, the manner in which it's exactly. taken, that is also something that has been talked about, and yeah. Now we're going in for something called pool testing. If you could talk a bit about that.
Yeah, the idea of doing pool testing is that since we have limitation of resources, we could pool in about 10 samples, and if that turns out to be positive, then we can screen all those 10 people. Otherwise, you have actually excluded those 10 those people, and then at one shot, you have excluded that. So that's the idea of doing it for screening a larger number of people
all
with
right.
the available resources.
And regarding this testing, if there's anything more you'd like to add, the reason that we're seeing people recover and then this what we're calling as a relapse, but concerned that it may never have left the body.
Yeah, by and large, our understanding is that this infection doesn't recur again, but there have been very few instances. If you look at the all the number of patients that have been cured, there have been very few of them who have developed relapses. So we have to look into what is the reason for this, whether it is any of these fallacies of the test. That's something which is still to be understood.
All right, we have a caller, Shipra from Noida. Go ahead with your question.
Hi, good morning. My husband is 46 years old. He's been a heart patient for 20 years and diabetic for the last 10 years. Under present circumstances, we are really unsure if it is okay to go down for a walk. In our society, there are no positive cases, so we just wanted to go down within the society and we just wanted to seek your advice if it's okay to do that.
All right, Dr. Shankar.
You can your husband falls in the high risk because he has got diabetes and he has got heart condition. So if he gets the infection, then the infection may take a bad shape. So he has to take all the precautions. So if he wants to go outdoor to do exercise inside the your society, he should use a face mask, the cloth mask that we are talking about. He should use that while walking, and he should make a social distance. That means that with other people, he should make maintain a distance of at least 2 meters. And once he comes out, comes back from the walk, he should wash his hands properly with soap and water for 20 seconds. Take out his mask by holding the mask, the string side of the mask. And wash it and keep it ready for next day.
All right. Well, I hope that it does help, Shipra. We have Varun calling from Bellary. Go ahead with your question, Varun. All right. Well, we've lost the line there. Dr. Sahe, if there's something you'd like to add to that, the earlier question regarding patients who are suffering from hypertension, who have a history of diabetes, where we're told again and again, they're the ones who have to really be careful because it'll be worse for them to contract a coronavirus.
Yeah, as you mentioned in the earlier questions, if he's able to exercise at home itself, that would be also good. And if he's going out, then he takes all these precautions that Dr. Praveen Shankar has just mentioned.
Right. And patients who are on various medicines during this period and for diabetes, for managing, any heart problems, etc., that all must continue as it is. And, because we get some questions regarding that as well and any further medication that they take as a precaution. But you'd be best placed to talk about that.
Yeah, that's a very important issue that... patients with diabetes should maintain their glucose control well, because once they have a good glucose control, they are less likely to have this severe manifestations. And the other issue is that with the ACE inhibitors and ARBs, there was a lot of discussion whether they should be stopped, because this virus enters into the cell using a receptor called the ACE2 receptor. And people who are on ACE inhibitors or ARBs tend to have a change in these levels of these ACE2 inhibitors. But after looking at all the data, all the scientific associations across the world have mentioned emphatically that all people should continue their medication. They should not stop any of these medications.
All right. We have a caller, Sameer from Pune. Go ahead with your question.
Hi. My question is regarding people who are using drugs such as methotrexate, who have been advised to do so by their doctors, because I've been suffering from psoriasis from the past few years. So my question is it still safe to use it in such circumstances where we have a risk of getting infected? And how does this affect our immunity?
All right, Dr. Shankar.
Yeah, if he is on methotrexate, that means he's immunosuppressed. So he has to take all the precautions. He has to stay indoors, do frequent hand washing, and all the precautions that we have already talked about, because he is a high risk. But he can't stop his methotrexate at this point of time until he becomes ill and seeks a medical advice on what to do with methotrexate at that time. Right now, he should continue with that.
All right. Yes, Dr. Sai?
Yeah, it would also be good that you recheck with your dermatologist who has advised this medication, because different organizations across the world have relooked at the indications for all these medications and have come out with their views on whether these medications should be continued or not. So it would be good that he reconsults his doctor and finds out with him.
All right, yes, that's very important. You should go back to his doctor and voice his concerns there. We have Varun calling from Bellary. Go ahead with your question.
Sir, my question is regarding the testing of COVID. They have a kit method. In that, they said they are going to identify the immunoglobulin, antibodies, IgG and IgM something. See, if the person suffers from normal cold, with the normal cold virus, so then also the body can release the immunoglobulin. How can you say that it is only due to COVID? If we test, if a person suffers from the normal fever or normal cold, okay, so then also his body can release the antibodies of immunoglobulin G and M. So with that test, how can you confirm that it is only from COVID virus?
All right, Dr. Sai.
Yeah, so what we're seeing is these antibodies are specific against these this antigen. So we are not testing generally the level of IgM or IgG, but we are looking at specific antibodies against this virus. So that is how it is different from the increase in antibodies that may happen with any other infection.
All right. And a lot of people have worries regarding if they develop a cough and cold. Earlier it was the flu season as well. And how do they know if it's coronavirus or not? That's one of the questions we get very often. Dr. Shankar?
Yeah, now we have to differentiate between three conditions: common cold, flu, and COVID-19. Common cold and COVID-19, the onset is insidious. That means you gradually develop symptoms, while in influenza, you suddenly develop symptoms. In common cold, you will have frequent sneezing, stuffiness of the nose, but you will typically you will not get fever. In COVID-19, you will get fever, cough, and tiredness. With influenza, you will also get all these things, but they will be of sudden onset. And warning symptoms that you can get, which will make you start suspicion that you are having COVID-19, is that along with these symptoms, if you start getting breathing difficulty, chest pain, or bluish discoloration of your tongue and lips, then you should get worried. So that's how you should differentiate between the three conditions.
All right. We have another caller from Delhi, Baldev. Go ahead with your question.
Ma'am, my question is, are there any people in the society or community who may have suffered from COVID-19? But have covered on their own because of their strong immunity.
Right, a very important question there, Dr. Sai, because this whole issue regarding asymptomatic people and people who recover, and this is the fear when we talk about the spread of this disease, because then it could affect the more vulnerable and people could be walking around with it without even realizing.
Yeah, if you look at the entire spectrum of COVID disease, what we see is that 80% of people may be asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic. Mildly symptomatic in the sense that they may just be having fever, cough, or maybe just a little bit of body pains, and they could have recovered. So 20% of them only require a hospitalization, and a few of them go on to require ventilated care, and these are the ones who tend to have a poor outcome. So there are large number of people who are going to recover with minimum symptoms, and these people will develop immunity, and they will also contribute towards the development of the herd immunity, which is going to sort of help in overcoming this virus over a period of time.
All right, we have a policeman calling in, Mr. Balakrishnan calling in from Vilapuram. Thank you so much for calling in. Go ahead with your question. Right, sir, go ahead with your question. Right, Mr. Balakrishnan, do go ahead. You can switch off the television. It's, I think, interfering in the audio, but do go ahead with your question. All right, well, we seem to have lost the line there with him, but Dr. Sahai, what we were talking about, what Dr. Shankar was also talking about earlier, this herd immunity issue, if you could just speak more about that, because this is something that, you know, the way it's been talked about by politicians is very different from the way that doctors talk about it and what herd immunity actually means.
Yeah, once a lot of people develop infection, 80% of them, as I mentioned, have mild symptoms, but they overcome the virus, they develop immunity with increase in their IgM levels initially and then the IgG levels. And this immunity contributes, helps in preventing reinfections, and also once a particular extent of the population develops this immunity, then the risk of infection, new infections comes.
And for this, a vaccine to be around is also very important. That's something that does help in this whole concept of herd immunity.
Absolutely.
All right, we have Balakrishnan back with us on the phone line. Yes, go ahead with your question.
Yes, ma'am. Sir, I'm a policeman. Basically, sir, I have severe diabetic, hypertension, asthmatic, and having cardiovascular medicine, ma'am. What's your suggestion, ma'am, during the crisis?
And you're going out and performing your duties as a policeman?
Yes, absolutely, absolutely, ma'am.
Right. Well, thank you for that. Dr. Shankar, please, if you could advise.
Yeah, actually, he is a high-risk patient, so he should talk to his authorities whether he should continue with his duty or not.
All right,
but
you advise that.
The point is that you should
ideally he should stay at home, yes, and take all the precautions that a high-risk person to get this infection has to take.
Right. Dr. Sahe, you were adding something?
Yeah, I wanted to add that you need to take all precautions while you're out of your home. See that you wear a mask always, apply the and hygiene measures, and that's going to protect you. And continue to maintain your blood pressure, diabetes in control, and continue to take your medication, heart disease, and also for the asthma.
All right.
And since you may be on steroids, you should never stop them if you are on steroids. In case you develop an infection, then you need to take the steroids during that period also.
But ideally, if you can, you know, work at the headquarters or at the offices, that would perhaps be best, is what both doctors seem to feel. Well, thank you so much, doctors, for joining us and answering all those questions. And thank you to all the viewers and all those who've called in. Do remember to call in with your queries. We're here every day and have experts taking all your questions.